is. Guys, it's the Hey Frase podcast with Paul Wharton. Coming up on today's show, I have a question for Paul about cultural appropriation. Is it just offensive no matter what, or is it the lack of credit of cultural appropriation that's offensive? We discuss.
Plus, and my spicy European lover wants to move to D.C. and I got cold feet.
D.C. Lottery. We love having them as a sponsor. How about winning a fabulous luxury handbag? It's possible with D.C. Lottery or up to $10,000 in cash prizes. But you gotta play. Just go to your local D.C. Lottery retailer, pick up the scratcher that looks like a handbag, and boom, you could win. DC Lottery, where lots of people win. And also, thank you to our sponsor, Crystal City Bid. You can warm up your fall weekends every Friday this month at Fridays in the Fountain in Crystal City with delicious beer and wine offerings and live entertainment. For more events, just visit crystalcity.org. All right, Paul.
Yeah.
All right.
Hey Frase, what's the phrase that you hear every day?
Hey Frase,
what's the phrase that you hear every day? Hey Frase, what's the phrase that you hear?
Da-da.
Tune in, yeah, you gotta tune in. Sarah Fraser on the mic and she about to begin. A co-host with the most Paul Warren looking fleek.
Hey,
take it from me, you should be listening.
Live from the nation's cap, pop culture at its best.
No need a second guess, separated from the rest. Entertaining nonetheless, many topics to address. Sarah, she's a glamorous, the number one hostess.
Hey, Paul Warren, how glamorous do I look with my skin completely, like, flaking and completely falling off?
Have you ever seen that movie, Death Becomes Her?
No, what?
That's you.
What?
With Goldie Hawn.
What happens?
And Meryl Streep, and they take the potion that makes them young forever, but they look like shit, like, in the very end. They're, like, 150 years old.
Oh, my God.
And they spray their makeup on with spray paint. And their skin is peeling off like a yes. snake.
I completely look. I thought I woke up this morning and I was like, you don't watch Game of Thrones, do you?
I don't.
Okay, well, there's this girl. There was this girl, but she ended up like being like burnt at the stake or whatever. But she had this like crazy like snake dragon skin like growing over and it was like scaly and everything. And I woke up this morning. And I was like, oh, shit, I look like that girl that died on Game of Thrones.
I'm like, okay, see, let me see. You should have called me first of all. Okay, you create a monster.
I sent,
people, no.
I
she didn't say shit, y'all. She didn't say nothing.
I sent you an email.
You didn't send me no email. What did you
I
send
did.
Me?
Honest to God, I sent you an email a couple weeks ago. I said, I'm going into Dr. Ruff's office, thanks to your introduction, and I'm going to have a facial. And I just want to give you the heads up, because I'll probably social media about
it. You should have texted me.
And then...
You know how many emails I get every day. I can't read all your little emails.
You don't even read mine.
I don't even read all your...
Okay,
you send me
it.
Too many.
All right, well, fine. I do
but wait, that. Look, I looked at her this morning. That's what you're... I don't even have to say nothing. You know what you look like. You should have told me. Because they can only really do one layer at a time. If you do two, your skin is way too thin to do two layers at a time. I mean, it's going to look great in the end, but this is not poor TV personality, okay? Let me just
oh
tell
my God.
You something.
I have been on TV the last 2 days. Because Paul and I, for those of you who are just tuning in or just started listening to the podcast... Paul Wharton and I have been friends for years and years, and we both kind of got to know each other at Fox 5, which is the local, one of the local channel affiliates here in D.C. So we both still contribute weekly there, and I had segments this week, and I said, we're just going to have to call this what it is, because in HGTV or HD.
High def, baby.
I think that's the when they redo the homes.
Home and garden.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to tell people. So we did. We just totally brought it up. And I was like, yeah, by the way, I had a chemical peel on a Friday. And Tuesday and Wednesday, all the skin is gone.
I'm taking it all in, and I'm wishing you well. But
you're
all I'm
so
going to say is,
shit.
You should have said something, and I would have told you.
Bless your heart. Well, you guys, we are super excited that you are joining us today here in Virginia. It was a great day. Paul,
yes.
The Democrats won.
Woo!
Hey, we're going to have Ralph Northam. I cannot stand Ralph Northam's accent more than anything.
God.
Those commercials drove me nuts.
The commercials were horrible.
So bad.
They were horrible.
I'm Ralph Northam, and I'm going to head to the White House and defeat that narcissistic maniac.
Oh, my
Trump.
God.
It was just so bad.
God.
But anyway, there were some big victories in Virginia.
Major.
First transgender U.S. She is a state legislator. She is going. Danica Rome, which was pretty amazing. In Virginia, so that was kind of cool to hear. And then, of course,
New Jersey, right?
And New Jersey, yep. Yeah. And then Ralph Northam, of course, gets in as the governor.
Oh, we're getting closer.
Yeah, that's true. Like, thank God. But anyway, I'm so glad that you guys are with us. And it was a very exciting day. Paul, how are you? What's going on?
Well, I'm good, Sarah. It's nice to see you today.
I know. Your face looks a lot better than mine. And it is true. You know, you start having a friend who maintains his skin all the time. And then now I'm like, oh, well, I want to look like that.
Well, there's a thing to it. You know, you got to get on a schedule. Really? You got to get on a schedule. And I talk about that in my new book, Pulling It All Together.
Hey, is that available for pre-order, by the way?
It's actually available for pre-order right now on Amazon. So please order it. And it comes out January 16th. So it ships on January 16th. And I'm doing a big book tour. Big, big, big book tour. I'm super excited about it. But, you know, there's different levels of maintenance. Okay? So, like, you are minimal maintenance. Okay? Like, you...
Wait, you know, you're on like a scale... You're the lowest.
Well, on a scale like, to, like, 1 to 10, you know, you're, like, a 3.
Okay.
Don't you think?
Yeah, I'm pretty low.
Because you do what you need to do when you need to do it, and other than that, you're not doing it.
It is true. It is true. Right. Like, I really... And some people get very upset at me. Like, they're like, well, I thought you didn't care what people think. And I'm like, not caring what people think about your body or what you look like doesn't mean no maintenance. Like, it's... Okay, those are...
Well, you were a 5 until last week when you didn't shower for 4 days. That knocked you down to a 3.
You know, by the way, I did shower today.
How do I smell? Wow, you're confident. Well, you were walking around all chest all sticking out. Does something, I assume you showered.
I know.
Something's kind of on fire.
Does this, something's on fire?
It really does, yeah.
I know. Is that okay? Well, we'll just see. Should we just see if there's flames? Oh, God. Our office, by the way, is like right next to a H&R Block. Oh, I guess they don't go by that anymore. And then it's with Pacers Running. So we are here at Pacers Running Store, but something smells like it's on fire.
A little bit.
Anyway.
A little bit.
Your book is available for...
Your face is totally distracting.
You're so full of it.
Yeah, so my book talks about different levels of maintenance. You were a 5, now you're a 3. I'm like somewhere about an 8.
Okay.
I stay on a maintenance schedule.
Okay.
Okay. Because I can't do all the stuff that it takes to make me look like this at once.
Right.
You can't do it. You'll go broke. You'll go crazy. You know, it's too much. You got to put this thing on a schedule.
Okay.
So, you know, your hair color, your Botox, your peels, all your normal maintenance that I do for myself, you know, all my creams and potions, as that guy told me from LA that cursed me out that time.
Yes.
You can use all your creams and potions all you want to. I'm like, when's the read starting? Okay. I'm ready. Yes, I use creams and potions.
Your
it's
point.
Paul Wharton Beauty.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
I make a living off that stuff.
Also available for order.
Exactly. Everything's for sale. So that's important. So you're catching up. You're getting to know how to do these things. I'm really proud of you.
Thank you.
I'm like your little papa bear.
You are really. I love, because once you get into a maintenance routine, you feel really good and you're like, oh, my skin looks amazing. Mm-hmm. And you really enjoy it. And these things are actually very pain free. So it's cool.
When this clears up, are you going to get Botox again?
Yeah, I think I'm going to do it.
Are you going to get your lips done again?
I don't know. Do you think I really need it? The lips, here's my only thing with the lips, because I've been looking at a lot of people with lip injections, and at some point, it seems like they always end up just having, like, one lip bigger than the other.
Sure.
It seems like it's very hard to keep it equal.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that Dr. Ruff could keep it equal, but, you know, you just... You don't necessarily
don't
need to go through that.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't want to go crazy.
Your lips.
I want to stay right around a 4 or 5.
Yeah. So listen, I've been going to a couple of big events. You know, this is like gala season in D.C. There was a big one last Thursday night. So the first Thursday in November, there's an event called Knockout Abuse, which helps fight domestic violence.
This is fight night too,
okay,
right?
So fight night is where all the guys go at the Washington Hilton. That's the same night.
Yes.
And they watch the fight and all that. Now some women are going over there. Actually, the mayor was over there and all that. You saw that?
Yeah. And a couple years ago when I was with the radio station, we went. So a couple years. But we always went to the fight night part, which there
were
fewer women, but there were some.
Of course, I go to the one with all the women. I go to the one with all the ladies. Not that I think I'm a lady, because I'm very much a man. But I like being like one of the few guys in a room full of women.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you are. You're very comfortable with women.
I'm very comfortable with all of them. I mean, I had a ticket at Fight Night, and I had a ticket at Knockout. But let me tell you something about revenge.
Okay. So wait, this all started with, you were like, you told me when you walked in, you were like, revenge is a dish best served cold. I was like, who the hell did you get revenge on?
Quiet revenge.
Mm.
Yeah. So do you remember me telling you about a friend of mine that's like a list Nazi? She does this holiday party every year.
Yes. And didn't last year she like didn't invite you or something? You weren't like on the list.
Last year she didn't invite me. This is someone who I know very, very well. Okay. I know all her business and she knows all mine. We've been friends for a long time, but, you know, the dynamic of our relationship has changed over the years.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This woman is very, very, very wealthy, okay? Like, very wealthy through marriage, all right? And I think in the beginning, and this is where the oversharing part starts, this is where the therapy comes in. No, but I think in the beginning, the dynamic of our relationship was I was on TV, and she had all this money. Do you know what I mean?
Got it.
So
sure.
I was a little bit famous, and she was pretty rich, and together, we could pretty much do anything.
Okay, gotcha.
Over the years, you know, I worked more, and then I kind of became my own guy. Do you know what I'm saying?
Sure, absolutely.
So she can go, or she doesn't have to go. Either way, I'm going first class. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't really matter if she's there or not. I love her as a friend, but I think for her, she was comfortable with the dynamic when she thought I needed her more.
I know lots of people like that. Yeah, and when you, like, step out of that mm-hmm. dynamic, they get very, very upset.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
So she does this thing where that's the reason why she left me off her holiday list, because I was, you know, I'm very busy, I'm doing this, I'm traveling here, I'm traveling there, and she's a little bit of a hater.
Yeah.
She would never say it, but she just is. So the day of her holiday party last year, she calls and says, or she texts and said, so I guess you're not coming to my holiday party. That really sucks. And I'm like, girl, please, you know you did not invite me to that holiday party. She knows she did not invite me to that holiday party. And the crazy thing is with her is she invited this guy. This good friend of mine, who he used to be a good friend, now he's not because he went to the holiday party.
And you didn't get, yeah, okay.
And I didn't go. My other good friends, like Erica, she knew I wasn't invited, and she didn't go. So she invited this guy and this girl who she used to talk about like a dog. She didn't want me to bring him anywhere because he was overweight, and she didn't like the fact that he was overweight. And I used to fight with her about that because I said, he's my friend, and I love him. I don't care what he looks like. He's my friend, and that's just that. And she would say, don't bring him around me. Yeah. It was like that.
Yeah, this person sounds like a terrible friend.
She's kind of a bitch, but she's going through her own thing. You know how women, when they're like the beautiful one, and then, you know, age starts, and then there's a whole nother, you know, group of women coming behind her, and they're always trying, you know, to push the boobs up further, and the waist in tighter, and the bigger diamonds, and it's just like a thing.
Right, okay? Right. I feel like it's a thing when you have too much money and time on your hands. You know what I'm saying? Like, you become so out of touch with, like, reality instead of just, like, going out, helping people. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. There's always people in your community that need help. There's always things, mm-hmm. you know, that keep you grounded. But
absolutely. So I'm laying all this groundwork to say that knockout is like the pinnacle. It's like where all of the women that are like her mm-hmm. come. For as much good as they do, they've raised over $10 million for...
Damn.
Yeah, for...
That's not easy.
...domestic violence charities. But it is like, it's like ground zero for these high maintenance women.
I mean,
they're all there. Okay.
Right.
So she buys a table every year. I used to go with her every year at her table. And then she got list Nazi about the table. And then one year she was like, I'm not getting a table. And then, of course, I ended up going with somebody else and she had a table and she didn't. Invited all these other people, just not me. So I always go as a guest of AT&T. So AT&T got more money than my girlfriend. So the positioning of the tables is very important in Knockout. Where you are in proximity to the stage.
And I see.
Do you see what I'm saying?
So you end up getting, I'm assuming you're right the hell up front.
Miss Thing, okay? They sneeze, I hand them a tissue. That's how close I am, okay? You know what I'm saying?
And this woman, where was her table this year?
Well, she's kind of always closed, but she's behind the stage. So she's like on the side. She sees like the butt of the person at the podium.
Okay, got it.
Do you know?
Yeah.
And I'm like looking at their face. So, oh my God, I had so much fun at this table. You know Simone Sanders from CNN?
Yeah, I think I do.
She is this really cool millennial. She's a CNN commentator. She's got short hair. She's fucking fabulous.
Okay.
She sat next to me. We cut up. We had so much fun. Dia Sims, the president of Combs Enterprises.
Okay.
She's the president of P. Diddy's company.
Okay.
She was also there. My friend Tanya Lombard from AT&T. The table was jumping. Okay. So I couldn't go to fight night. Because it gives me so much joy to sit closer to the front than my list Nazi friend. It just does. When everybody stands up and I look over and she catches my eye and she's like looking at the ass of the person and I'm like, look at her mascara. Don't she look good? That girl's face look good. Oh, you can't see her face. It's terrible.
Oh my God, Paul, your world. I love it. Oh my God. Always up front.
Yeah.
That should be the next name of your book, too. Ooh. I love that. Always up front. Always and that is front. The truth.
Wait, no. I had one that I was writing my memoirs, and it's called I Came and Coach.
Wait, but you left, don't you?
But I came back in a private plane. You remember, because I went to New York when I flew there when I left at 19. I went there in coach. I had a suitcase, and I went in coach.
And then when you came back, you flew in your own plane?
Not my own. Well, it was a friend, but I did fly back on a private plane when I moved back.
Oh, my God. You guys, we have a ton of stories to get to, by the way. We have to talk about, people are very unhappy that Chris Brown and R. Kelly teamed up and came up with a song called Juicy Booty. I'll tell you why people are pissed about that. Would you send Facebook your porn videos or your naked photos? Because they're asking for those as a way to prevent revenge porn. And I think this is so strange that they want to do it, but they say they want to do it. And then the other thing is, did you see the woman riding the bicycle? I think the picture came out maybe like a week and a half. Who was giving Trump the finger?
Yeah, she got fired.
She got fired. So I want to know if you feel like she should have gotten fired. Because she's, by the way, now a huge online hero. Like,
oh, people absolutely.
$14,000 has been raised in a GoFundMe for her, just like to give her money because she got fired from her job. So this GoFundMe has been set up. She's getting thousands of dollars in donations. And she says she's already been inundated with so many job offers that she's trying to take the next couple of weeks to sit back and find out what job she wants to do. Yeah, so I mean, I guess it really worked out. But I just wondered if you thought... I feel like that's a very scary trend, by the way, that your company...
Well, you know, I've talked about that before. I've talked about some of the things, and I've asked you before, God, can somebody fire us for this? Because we say some pretty outrageous things. And it's kind of like, you know, I like being able to be free, and that's why we're doing this podcast, so we can be honest and talk about certain things. But there's probably a lot of stuff I do in my day-to-day life that if I could get fired... Maybe they'd fire me.
We can't get fired anymore, really. I mean, we can from our partnership jobs, like with Fox or whatever. But my thing is always this, and you see it with no matter what celebrities or shows, I think it always goes in ebbs and flows. And there are very few people who've been able, really the only thing you're beholden to are your sponsors.
Sure.
And I really find like now, for the most part, unless you do something so horrendous, for example, Lance Armstrong cheating, you know, he lost all those endorsements. People feel very scammed. I think you have to be pretty extreme now. And more celebrities are just distributing their own stuff. They're coming out with their own makeup. You know what I'm saying? Because I think they're tired of... to me, this story drove me nuts. I think this is exactly what's wrong with corporate America. And by the way, we have an email from a listener who wants to know how she can quit her job and start like living her dream. But I think this is so what's wrong with companies and why so many people are quitting. They're moving to startups. They're going to young millennial, you know, startups. Because... it's just stupid shit like this that companies feel like they own you.
Yeah. I mean, I got to say, just to touch on the Kevin Spacey thing just one more time. I mean, I know it's not a popular thing to talk about, but it made me a little nervous that Netflix would cancel his show off of an allegation.
Really?
It did, because, like, I remember a guy told me once that he thought, you know, I kind of joke over relationship in my head, but this guy thought I was, he thought we were like dating or something, and we absolutely weren't. It was like what he perceived it to be.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And I remember hearing that story and thinking, oh my God, he's like for real. He's like sitting here telling me that, you know, we dated and we held hands walking down the thing. And I'm like, well, I walked down the thing, but I don't remember. You know what I'm saying?
Right. So this person has fabricated this in their mind so much that they believe it's true. And they could say something about you that you know to be completely false.
Well, right. And I do believe Anthony Rapp because I know him. I've met him. Right. I've been to his house on New Year's Eve. I've hung out with the guy. I mean, I think he's a solid guy. But some people do lie. I mean, somebody could essentially make up an allegation and accuse someone of something, and then their whole life falls apart before you even know if it's true or not.
But my thing with the Kevin Spacey thing is I think Netflix would have stood by him if it was one allegation. But, you know, I'm sure you've read, too, with Variety and everything, people from House of Cards that work with him are like, oh, my God, he's been abusive. He's sexually harassed other men. I think Kevin Spacey, Harvey Weinstein, these guys, Bill O'Reilly, you know, once... one person comes out. I mean, it's not like it's one person and then everyone else going, hey, you know what? This is a really stand-up guy.
Sure.
He wouldn't do this. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're right. You're right. I forgot all that stuff that was going on actually.
This woman, I'm just like, are you freaking kidding? Jill Briskman is her name. And she told the Post on Saturday that after photos of her flipping off the presidential caravan while riding a bike on October 28th started appearing online and in news reports, she thought she would alert her employer. So she went to her government employer, Ackman LLC, a government contractor. When she returned to work on Monday the 30th, she informed the Human Resources Department. Briskman, a 50-year-old mother of two, was fired the next day. They said, quote, we're separating from you. Basically, you can't have a lewd or obscene thing on your social media. So they were calling flipping him off, quote, obscene. Do you think giving someone the middle finger is obscene?
What if the motorcade was about to run her over as a biker? I mean, you know, I mean, I've flipped people off before.
I mean, I think it's ridiculous, too. While Ackman dismissed her, she said the company only reprimanded a male employee who posted lewd comments on his Facebook page that used the company at his cover photo. As his cover photo, she said that the guy called somebody a fucking liptard asshole on Facebook. Okay. Oh, that's a good one. Right. She says, how is this any less obscene than me flipping off the president? She told the Huffington Post. How is that fair? So far, Ackman has not commented, the company, but she's being inundated with job requests. And good for her.
She'll come out on top.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Right? And you kind of call out your company. I mean, you know, your company basically shows their...
Sure.
I mean, do you think she should have... Like, what's your thought? Do you think
I wouldn't have said anything to HR. I mean, it was the back of her. I would have denied it. She'd do like the president. Just deny. You know, it wasn't me. It was not me, okay? I was not there.
What's up, me? We have to thank two of our sponsors, DC Lottery. We love working with them, and they have an amazing handbag scratcher that you need to give out. I love scratchers. My mom every year gives them to us for Christmas, and they're so much fun. So you need to pick up your DC one.
Ladies, as you know, a great outfit can totally define your look. And a beautiful designer handbag can take that outfit up a notch. So how would you like to win a luxury brand handbag to enhance your wardrobe? Well, play the new handbag scratcher from the DC Lottery. Not only can you win cash prizes of up to $10,000, but enter the second chance drawing and you have a chance to win one of seven luxury brand handbags or cash prizes to help you pick out your own new bag. Play the handbag scratcher today, and you just might win that handbag you've had your eye on. Visit your local DC Lottery retailer and ask for the scratcher that looks like a handbag. Only from the DC Lottery, where lots of people win.
Okay, so you guys, also, we love Mervis Diamonds. They're amazing.
That's right. They've got a great event happening this weekend, the Holiday Preview, so you can enjoy early access to exclusive holiday deals. That includes engagement rings, wedding bands, earrings, necklaces, and so much more at two Mervis stores, Tyson's and Rockville. Check them out at MervisDiamond.com.
Love it. Hope to see you guys. We might stop by this weekend. And Paul...
And the Mandy and David team at Compass Real Estate. I just love, love, love this team. If you're looking to buy or sell a home, they'll help you every step of the way. The Mandy and David team, they work at every price point, Sarah, which I love, in every zip code in the DMV. Check them out at MandyandDavid.com.
Love Mandy and David.
Yeah.
One thing that I want to circle back on, because it kind of involves the Harvey Weinsteins and the Kevin Spacey, more companies have dramatically increased their insurance coverage against sexual harassment complaints in recent years following high-profile scandals as corporate America reckons with the growing risks of workplace misconduct. Does that seem like terrible to you that big companies... I mean, isn't that crazy? Like,
well,
when we get our own talk shows...
It's kind of crazy. I mean, you know...
Are you going to have... When you have your own talk show,
yeah.
Paul Wharton
yeah.
style,
ooh.
And you're
just
bringing...
the thought of it makes me hard. Okay. We might have an issue today.
Your studio is just covered with all kinds of Paul Wharton bottles.
Oh, my God. Okay. I'm going to mess my shorts.
All right. This is... Maybe this is a bad example. Would you ever get sexual harassment insurance for yourself?
Not for me, because it's... I can keep mine separate.
Do you think you really can, though?
I think so. Have you ever seen me do something wrong?
Yes, with AJ.
AJ?
When you were drinking, you're like nestling. Look, she doesn't have a problem with it. Neither do I. But I'm just saying, I would get it for myself. Are you kidding? I'm feeling the older I get, I'm sure like the just more handsy I'm going to get. And the more I'm just going to be like, show me your penis.
Well,
like,
you know I used to sleep with my assistants. That's the whole thing. I told you this, right? It was horrible. It's like, it's funny. Awesome. I was watching one of the stand-ups I watched Joan Rivers do. She was like, oh, staff. I don't learn their names. She was like, walk around my house like, staff, who's going to fuck me tonight? Joan Rivers said that. And I was like, huh, there's something to that. Power of suggestion. But anyway, I used to like do that until... Yeah, I told you about my road trip down to Myrtle.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I had to drive the assistant because he was too hungover.
Yeah, and you were like, that's it.
Yeah, you can't be worn out from, like, having sex with me and I had to drive the car. No, you know what I mean?
Oh, my God, that is the best story. You just inspired me, like, now, because Paul pitches TV shows, and I went to Real Screen, which is, like, this place you can pitch shows last year, so I've been pitching some. And now my next one I really want to pitch is, like, basically where people come in and talk about all their, like, sexual harassments that they've done to people, and we see if we would give them their own company, like, would we insure you?
Well, have you ever slept with somebody at work?
I actually have not. And I'm trying to think of I guess I've hooked up with listeners over the years for radio. But, mm-hmm. you know, we didn't work together. They, like, listened.
Yeah.
But, no, I mean, radio, you've seen the men of radio, right?
Yeah. Well, let me tell you. We're moving on from that. But
they're really hard to get down.
I'll tell you, I have the hottest little like triangle thing going on at one of my jobs when I was.
How many women were involved?
None.
Wow, that's great.
It was me and two guys, but they didn't know about each other. But they shared a wall in their cubicle.
I love it.
Wait a minute. I was in New York City, and I had created this curriculum that American Express was, like, licensing me for to come in and teach people, like, you know, how to dress and shit at work. Do you believe that?
Yes,
they
I
took
can believe
the bait,
that.
And, like, it was crazy. I made a whole bunch of money. But anyway, so
I can see that.
There were these two guys there, both straight. Yeah. And they shared a cubicle wall. So as I was standing over them, they couldn't see each other, but I'm looking at both of them. I ended up having an affair with both of them at the same time.
I don't think they were really straight. Don't you think they were questioning?
They were both married.
What? Yeah. Paul? Oh my God. Did you have an issue sleeping with two married men? Clearly not.
Okay. I guess I didn't. No.
Clearly
but,
not.
But now I wouldn't do that any longer. You know, I'm past that phase in my life. I've evolved.
I get that.
I was only 22 years old.
Okay. Well, you were really, really young.
I was 22.
Young.
But we had some good times.
I know.
Still keep in touch with one of the guys.
Really?
Yeah, he lives in Nashville. He's fabulous.
Oh, my God. Wait, no. Is he still married?
No,
to a woman?
He's not.
He's out. Okay, he's out. He's like...
No, he's... You know, he dates women.
Okay, so he's bi.
It's something like that. Yeah,
I don't know why
like
I need
that.
A label. I have no idea why I need a label.
It's crazy. But, yeah, it's crazy.
Well, a couple of stories, a couple of pop culture stories. One, do you believe that Mariah Carey has, first of all, she's getting sexual harassment charges from a bodyguard who says that, whatever, she used to walk around her lingerie and the same thing, like then her like vagina would be hanging out. She'd be like, oh, oops. And, you know, she'd tuck in her vagina, you know, flaps or whatever.
Oh,
but,
my God. God. I'm drinking
exactly
my beet juice.
Like that. But, you know, but do you believe Mariah Carey has undergone gastric bypass surgery? I hope this is not true.
What doctor would do that? What doctor would risk her life? Gastric bypass is for people that are obese. Mariah might have had on a few extra pounds, but she definitely wasn't obese.
She says that, supposedly for this story, that Mariah was getting so much flack from her fans, and she found it hard to even move doing any of her dance moves, that she underwent gastric bypass surgery to lose about 50 pounds. Oh, my God.
50 pounds?
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah, she
Has she lost it yet?
Well, I think that this is why I feel like this story is true, because they did show some before and after pictures of the 47-year-old, and it does look like she's a lot thinner, and it happened fairly quickly. Like, she was just at the Hollywood Walk of Fame, and she looked really good at TCL Chinese Theater.
Mm-hmm.
And they're saying that this is all post-gastric bypass surgery. You had the scoop on Tamar and Vince. So I kind of watch Braxton Family Values a little bit, and we've had... oh my God, why am I Tracy Braxton on the podcast?
No.
So, but what's all this like divorce drama?
Well, you know, we've heard a lot about potentially Vince being abusive to Tamar.
Right.
You know,
right.
There was that incident where the cops had to come to the hotel, to the Ritz-Carlton, I think it was, in Atlanta, where he bit her finger. But she posted on Instagram, I think yesterday, but I think she took it down. She posted on Instagram kind of a long story about why they're getting divorced. And basically, she says that she alluded to the fact that he might have a girlfriend. Several girlfriends.
He's so gross. I don't know how. Okay.
So you can see that even though he's gross?
Yeah, because I think that, you know, celebrity changes everyone. Even if you are like D-list celebrity, even if you're the husband of, it's kind of like Wendy Williams' husband, right. Kevin. I feel like Kevin Hunter is not attractive at all. But right. Of course he could have like a side piece. You know what I'm saying? There's always somebody that's willing any a little amount of fame.
Do men always need to be the man when it comes to their famous women, their famous wives or girlfriends? Is that what it is?
Well,
they need somebody that worships them more or that feels like they're superior.
I think that, I don't know, I feel like different men feel different ways. You know what I'm saying? I think there's a lot more men nowadays that are secure with not being the lead. But I think like with Tamar and Vince's whole thing, you know, Vince started out as the lead.
Sure.
You know, and I think that's hard. Mm-hmm. Right. And then Kevin, you know, he kind of really helped make Wendy's career. But now, like, does Wendy really need him? No.
No.
You know what I mean? So I think there comes an insecurity part of it.
Yeah, so apparently Vince put Tamar out of his house, and she put in quotes like, your house. And she was like, how are you going to put me out the house when I'm the house of cards? And I took that as, I'm the bitch out here making all the money. Do you know what I'm saying?
Because, that could be with her music and everything.
I think now he might be managing Remy Ma. Before, of course, we all know he managed Lady Gaga, or in some capacity he did.
Yeah, like briefly, right? Or helped kind of discover her or something.
Do something, but I don't know if them checks are still coming in. And you know he had that judgment against him from Sony. So, yeah, they're definitely having some financial issues. But, you know, Tamar is pumping. This was the wrong time to retirement. Let me tell you what's going to happen. She's coming out of retirement.
I gotta hear her music, because she's gonna be on tour, by the way, with Escape.
She's great.
So Escape, Tamar and Monica are gonna open, which I really want to go to Escape. Are you gonna go to that show?
Is that on Sunday?
It's the 26th of November.
We need to try to go to that.
Who's going, by the way? If you guys are going to Escape, you need to tweet us at Hey Frage, at Paul Wharton. It's Paul Wharton on Twitter, right?
It is.
You still looking at my face?
I can't take my eyes off of it.
If he's not smelling my armpits, he's looking at my face. Oh my God, and last week when you were looking at my nails and you were like, I'm just wondering what's under your nails.
Oh God, I know. It's too much. Some of the stuff we should talk about off the show, right?
Oh my God, so true. Do you think R. Kelly and Chris Brown should be doing a song called Juicy Booty together?
Let me hear it.
I actually like it.
Oh, wait. I like the little beat. Come on. Come on.
Tell me I'll do that.
Okay. Not what I was expecting, actually.
Two of my favorite people, and it's terrible. I love R. Kelly.
This is horrible. Wait, you love R. Kelly, but you hate Kevin Spacey?
Yeah.
Ew.
I really do. I have prejudice. I really like black people. Juicy.
Juicy booty. Booty.
Oh my God, I think this song is amazing.
It's got a nice little beat to it. I won't lie.
Juicy.
Booty. I can't be singing along to this. Cut it. Ridiculous.
Well, a female reporter for USA Today says that you should be ashamed of yourself if you have purchased Chris Brown's recent collaboration and album. He's got a new album out, which has 45 songs, Heartbreak, A Full Moon, and features this song, Juicy Booty, with two of the biggest sex offenders in the rap game, according to this article. She says that they have exploited, used, beat women, and yet these two still seem to have a career. And she says it's absolutely disgusting that and she basically brings race into it. And she says that people like Harvey Weinstein, Kevin Spacey, who assaulted for the most part white individuals, these people are no career, they cannot work again. But because R. Kelly and Chris Brown abused black women, they somehow still remain to have their careers fairly much intact.
I don't support either one of them.
I know. I really can't support their music either. But it's funny. Over the weekend, I watched. Did you ever watch the movie Get Out?
Yeah.
Oh my God, you did? Paul, why didn't you text me immediately? That movie was so good.
Because it reminded me of you and it scared the fuck out of me. I was like, oh, that girl looked like Sarah.
Oh my God.
It did. It did kind of remind me, didn't it? Of your life in Maine.
It did not. No, we don't kidnap black people and then make them like white.
I know, but the beginning part, it did kind of remind me of you.
I freaking loved that movie. It was so good. Did Jordan Peele win an Oscar for that?
I don't think anything.
What?
I mean, I didn't see him win anything.
I saw it.
It did really well, though.
Two films over the weekend. Chris Brown's documentary. It was all right. Oh, and then I saw John Mulaney, the comedian. Ugh, terrible.
In person?
Yes, he was awful. He's so boring. Ugh.
Really?
Oh, my God. He's the worst.
Oh, God.
I'm sure I'm going to get
a hate
mail.
Which one is he, by the way?
He's so forgettable. That's the thing. Dan is such a fan of John Mulaney, right? So we went to Dark Constitution Hall. John Mulaney makes a joke.
Constitution Hall?
Yeah.
He's big, huh?
Like sold out, yes. And it was all white people. And he makes reference to that, basically. He's like,
that's why you didn't like it.
It's true. I know. I really don't.
So, this guy.
Yeah.
He's like a dork.
Oh, my God. It was so bad. Oh, God. I mean, I need Donnell Rawlings in my life and Dave Chappelle.
Well,
you know?
Were people dying laughing?
They loved it. Yes.
Did Dan love it?
Oh, Dan loved it. Everyone around us was cracking up. This couple in front of us, they were, like, making out and picking each other's hair. And they, like, loved it. I was more entertained by them than John Mulaney. I don't know. I just don't get his humor. I don't like it. But anyhow. But then I saw Get Out. And I was like, Paul, this movie is incredible.
It really was.
I have a question for you about cultural appropriation.
Mm-hmm.
If you haven't seen Get Out, you need to watch it immediately.
Sure.
And essentially, to me, I read it as this is about cultural appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
Keep talking.
So, what did you think was appropriate?
Okay,
her behavior?
No. Like, I think the whole film was about cultural appropriation.
Okay.
Essentially saying that white people culturally appropriate everything about black people. And if they could, they would literally, essentially take everything that was black, except for their black skin, and transform it to white.
Well, I think that they were saying that they would take everything about their prowess, their power, their sex drive. Like, they wanted the white brain with the black body and stature.
I think you're right.
Do you know?
I think that's it. Yeah.
That's what it was.
I think, yes.
Do you know?
But that's what I kind of want to know. It's like, I was starting to read, like, more about it. And then everyone's like, you got to watch it again. There's so much meaning to it. And, and of course, that the mansion or whatever, the home where it takes place, looks like this southern plantation in the north, you know? And then you come and you realize what's happening. I don't want to give it away for people because it's so good if you haven't seen it.
The sunken place?
Oh, my God, yeah.
Don't be stirring no tea around me. I don't do that.
Here's my question for you about cultural appropriation.
Yeah.
Do African American people dislike cultural appropriation altogether, or do they hate that people culturally appropriate but don't give the black community credit, or the Asian community, or whatever it is that they're appropriating?
I would say, in terms of Twitter and social media and the things that you hear, I think that they don't like it. Most people don't like it at all. It's a sensitive subject because if you've taken everything from me, leave me with, who I am, who my ancestors were, the things that I've adapted to be.
So even if Kim Kardashian and the Kardashians were like, look, we love black women, we love their figures, and essentially we have taken their figures, we've taken their style, and we've made it our own, but we credit them, like, that would still be offensive?
Well, I mean, you're asking probably the wrong person because I'm just not that sensitive about a lot of stuff. Do you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Really,
I think to each his own, his or her own. I really do believe that you have to let people live. I believe in being free to let people do what they want to do, look the way they want to look. If you want to bleach your skin, it's not good for you, but do what you need to do. if you're a black girl.
If you want to become Sammy Sosa Jr. Okay.
Right. If you're a black girl that wants to wear a 36-inch lace front blonde wig down to your ass, then that's what you want to do. Am I going to say that you're appropriating, Caucasian look or something? No, not necessarily. She just thinks blonde looks good on her.
I don't know that you can really appropriate white people, though, can you? I mean, where we still have so many race issues, and it really wasn't that long ago. I'm like, can you really appropriate white people? I don't know.
You always drag me down. You always want to talk about obsession with black dick? What is it, Sarah? You know what? Let's just put it out on the table. Let's get to the bottom of it.
Well, I do. I really am attracted to black men. I say that all the time. If I was not with Dan, I would never be with another white guy ever. I think to me what it is nothing against white people. I'm white. I'm very happy. But I'm a person that loves something like different or okay. not that I grew up with. You know
How
what I'm saying?
How did that happen coming from Maine, coming from where you
because
came from?
Because to me, you grow up with looking like mm-hmm. you. Everybody looks the same.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And then you go out and you're like, oh my God, you move to Washington, you move to New York, you get out in the world, you go to Ireland, you live and you see all these other people and you're like, wow, these people are so gorgeous. Why do I want to just like marry one person or some right. redneck from Dresden, Maine?
Right.
Fuck
okay.
that. Now okay. I want to like share, you know, I want to like be married to an Asian guy for 5 years, a white guy wow. for 5 years, a black guy for five,
nice.
10 years. And then I just love yeah. different points of view. You know what I'm saying? Don't you think it's boring to be married to somebody that just grew up in the same perspective you did?
You know, you're probably right. You know, I've never really dated a Latino guy, except now this guy slid into my DMs
Ooh,
on Instagram. I'll show you his picture.
Well, I want to see his photo. Yeah. Yes.
So anyway, you know, I don't really do this, but, you know, I was home bored and he always messages me. So I'm like, I'm going to talk to this guy. So, yeah, I mean, now he's like really trying to like date or something.
Oh
and
God,
English is his
try.
Second language.
I think that's terrific. I mean, I'm not saying it always works out. I think some traditions, like, people are very conservative. Like, I don't think I could ever really, you know, date, like, a Saudi Arabian guy who didn't want me to drive. Like, I don't think that will work out.
Right.
But I would give it a go.
Like, you want to ride on the passenger side? Okay. Sure, pick me up.
Paul, Facebook wants your nude photos. So I'm sure over the years, I mean, I've just, like, showed some titty.
Mm-hmm.
You take some pictures, and then you think the next day when you're sober, you're like, oh, my God, maybe I shouldn't have done that. Facebook wants those photos, they claim, in order to know that it's yours and then immediately take it down, and they say that it will prevent people from sharing your revenge porn. Would you send Facebook voluntarily your pictures?
No, I don't send any pictures of myself naked, ever.
Ever?
Ever.
Would you have... Wait, didn't you tell this story? Don't you have a tape out there you're worried about, or no?
No, I have possession of the tape.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. Okay, good. So you're all set.
I'm good.
Okay, well, Facebook is saying in order to combat revenge porn, and they're already trying this, by the way, overseas. They're having people send videos and images to them. And they're going to store a copy. They're not going to store a copy, but the image is still being transmitted and processed, leaving forensic evidence in memory and potentially on disk. But they're saying that Facebook is piloting the program in Australia in partnership with the county, a government agency dedicated to online safety. Next, it will test it in the United States, Britain, and Canada. And it would be like sending yourself your image in the email, but obviously this is a much safer, secure, end-to-end way of sending the image without sending it through either.
How about just
I don't
not
understand
sending
that.
It?
I agree, but I don't think people are ever going to stop sexting and sending stuff to you.
Is it fair to ask for a picture when you're not willing to reciprocate? Because that's totally my jam.
That's what you'll say.
I'm like, well, you can send one if you want, but I'm not sending anything back.
But I'm going to say, are these people going, hey, I really want to send you a nude photo?
Well, they're like, ooh, I like, you know, me horny or whatever. And I'm like, okay, well, send what you want, but you're getting nothing. And I tell them, like, you are not sending anything back. Like, I just don't.
Do they text that way too, me horny?
Mm-hmm.
No, I think it's fine. I think people, it's always buyer beware. What? Oh, my God. This is the guy you're talking to? Oh, my God. Paul just showed me this incredibly nude photo, and this guy has, like, a tattoo very close to his penis, like almost a tattooed belt. Wow. And he is
it's
definitely...
never going to happen.
You don't think so?
No, I'm just talking on text. I mean, this is not my... I can't.
Well,
I'm too grown
comfortable.
For this.
We should text him back. Excuse me, sir. Would you send these photos to Facebook? We need to know. Your girlfriend, Omarosa, love a couple more stories, and then we'll get to this listener email who wants advice. So Omarosa, apparently, after her wedding, which you went to her wedding, right? Which was at Trump Hotel. Politico has a story out today that says that Omarosa went to the White House immediately after her wedding, took her 39-person wedding party there, and took a bunch of wedding photos without ever asking anyone. According to an inside source, fellow aides and security officials were beside themselves by the surprise when the bride showed up in full wedding attire and then went in and staged photos in the Rose Garden and West Wing. Has your girlfriend Omarosa said anything about this?
No. No, what's funny about that is, you know, I had a lot of anxiety about being in that hotel that day.
Oh, I'm sure,
you know, that's not my thing.
Right.
It's not my thing. I was really trying to take one for the team and be a good friend that one last time. And, yeah, they did kind of disappear for a minute.
So apparently she's not allowed to post them publicly because they could reveal sensitive security information. But I got to tell you, I actually admire her about that. I feel like she's a woman that's like, you know what? Screw it. Trump was in Mar-a-Lago. I feel like she's like, this might be the only time I'm in the White House, so I'm bringing everybody.
Yeah, that's pretty ballsy. You know, we went, like I was telling you, we went to the White House the night before the wedding. Was it the night before the wedding? Yeah, it was the night before.
Okay, and what'd you guys do?
So we were at the rehearsal dinner.
Okay.
Okay, that was at Trump Hotel. Oof, whatever. Oh, I was just drinking heavily. No, really. I gave them so much money at the bar. I was like, just keep this shit full. Like, keep it coming. Because I cannot even believe. And the craziest thing about that hotel, the craziest thing is it's a gorgeous hotel. Hmm. And the bar is full of people that you do not think would be there.
Yeah, well, totally, totally.
Have you been in there?
I've been there too. Well, only when it first opened. Remember, and we did that whole, we were going to do a party at Trump Hotel and rent a suite. So we walked in and it was like a bunch of, you know, just whatever your typical Midwestern. It looked like all my relatives.
They had like John Deere hats and sunburn on their nose and their face was peeling like yours.
And the place is gold. Yes.
It's all gold. And they wheel around a champagne cart. It's fabulous. I'd love to go and hang out there, but I just won't.
It's like $60 a glass. Yeah.
Oh, I was having a good old time.
Over the weekend, are you having the ongoing Apple? They're apparently working on their bug, but were you typing I over the weekend only to get an A and a question mark?
Yeah. So basically what you do is you go to settings.
Yeah. How do you do this?
Okay. You go to settings and then you go to keyboard.
Okay. Love it. Love it.
Okay. Are you there?
Okay.
Okay, settings, then general, then keyboard.
Keep going, because my deal is I tried this shortcut.
Settings, general, keyboard, and then you go to text replacement.
Okay.
And then you put in, see how I have I, so you put the plus sign there.
Yep, okay.
And then it says phrase, you put the lowercase I, and the shortcut is the capital I, and then you hit save.
Okay.
And that should take care of it.
Okay, well, I'm going to try that. I've tried it once before, and it did not work. So pissed. Apple today says that they're working on a fix, and they weren't sure what caused the bug that keeps having people get the question mark and the A. Some people using their iPhones, iPads, iTouch devices have started seeing that, and they're saying they're not exactly sure what the problem is, but hopefully to be fixed.
Yeah, popped up on my iPad this morning.
Oh, what? It's so damn annoying. Oh, my God.
But I love anything that's the great unifier. I swear. I mean, it's so weird, but I love that it's happening to everyone. I mean, it's kind of like, oh, that happened to you too? Wow.
Let's all get together. Yeah. As workout intensifies for people, more and more people are having a very toxic reaction that can actually have you end up in the hospital when your muscles work too hard. They seep out a poison.
I heard about that.
Have you heard this?
Soul Cycle.
Yes. So more people, especially in spin classes, are pedaling fast on stationary bikes and doing extreme hour-long classes, which are very, very hard on the body and the legs. In fact, sometimes you're so sore and wobbly that you think you just have muscle aches, but it causes excruciating pain. Your urine turns like a dark shade of brown and you feel nauseated. More and more people are ending up in the hospital, and it's called like a, oh my God, rhabdomyolysis or something. It's a rare but life-threatening condition often caused by extreme exercise, and it occurs when overworked muscles begin to die and leak their contents into the bloodstream, straining the kidneys and causing severe pain.
I told you.
Oh, my God.
You better sit at the bar with me.
And that's why...
Have yourself a glass of wine.
We'll be drinking. I haven't done a Soul Cycle. I haven't done a bike class
in
so long.
That scares me. I have to tell you, Soul Cycle scares me so much.
Really?
Yeah. Listen, all my friends are like, you need to calm.
Devotees, yeah.
Oh, the music, Erica Gutierrez. She's like the biggest Soul Cycle crazy person. Like, she goes and buys... She waited outside the sample sale to buy all the Soul Cycle gear with all these other crazy women. It was kind of crazy. But it scares me being on. I used to have asthma when I was a kid. And when I first started working out, I remember going to like a gym when I was like 18 or something. And I was on a bike, and I just got so winded that the idea of Soul Cycle just scares me.
Oh my God.
Have you tried it?
No, I'm trying to think of when I took a last like cycling class. I don't think I ever really have.
When were you last in the gym? I never hear you talk about it.
Never know. I actually did go this past Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Dan and I, you know, we've been trying to plan more date nights.
Okay.
We are that couple that has to schedule date nights together. Mm-hmm. Like tonight, Wednesday nights are our date nights.
Okay.
So I'm trying to get him to go to Top Golf, but he feels like that's something that he does with the guys, and he wants to keep it with the guys.
Right.
Which, don't you think that's stupid? Like, when you're like in a relationship, does your partner have like just things they do with their friends? Isn't that ridiculous?
What the hell are you asking me for? You know I got problems with relationships. You know what I mean? Oh, by the way, I got to tell you what happened this morning.
Okay, good. Well, and you know what? Because I picture you more like when you're dating someone, yeah. Do you have just things that you do with your friends or yeah. Do you invite everybody? Like, I'm like, damn, that's so ridiculous.
No, I like to do things just with my friends because I think that's where relationship issues start when you go out with your friends and your mate and you're all drinking. I was out with my friend the other day, a friend of mine and her husband. Everybody was drinking. And they ended up getting into the worst fight in the cab on the way home that I had the cab pull over and I got out and it was like nowhere near where I was going. I just started walking on the street.
You were like, I'm done.
I was like, oh, that's funny. I'm going right here.
Why do you think the friends bring out the worst in you?
Well, because sometimes as a part of a couple, you don't want the other person to reveal too much or talk about certain things that you don't want them to talk about.
I see.
Then they go down that road and you're trying to send them signals and it gets weird. And then the other one knows they think that you're trying to silence them. So then they get an attitude.
I see.
And then you have an attitude and then you shut down because you want to leave because your mate is telling way too much to these friends that you don't want them to know. So that's what happens.
I get it.
I see it all the time.
What happened this morning? That you were talking about. Is this with your man, your Belgian man?
Yes, his name is Renzo.
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 I love Renzo. It reminds me of Lorenzo Lamas.
But really. Lorenzo Lamas. You say it so sexually. Lorenzo Lamas.
Lorenzo Lamas. Like, that's what I think of. And that's what I picture this guy looking like. Lorenzo Lamas.
No, he doesn't look like Lorenzo Lamas.
Bring up a picture.
Lorenzo's pretty cute. I've showed you the pictures before.
You did? I feel like
from
drinking?
Rome. Were you drinking? You're always drinking. You're always drinking. But no, he said to me this morning, it was so interesting. He's like, you know, I just want to let you know that I would consider moving to D.C. You know, this man lives in Rome and Brussels. And he says, I would consider moving to Washington, D.C. and living there. That would be like good for fine with me.
Oh, my God.
Screech, 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 stop, emergency brake, mayday, mayday, get me the hell out of here. It's so weird how things change when somebody says they'll come to you, you know, because the whole, like, I have romanticized this relationship in my head as being something that is like, oh, I'll explore the world. And, you know, he wants to buy a house in Barcelona. So then he'd have a place in Brussels, the country house in Rome,
okay.
And a place on the beach in Barcelona. That's a good life to me. And then I could come back to D.C. and kind of do my thing. And then I could just pop around the rest of the world with him. But if he comes here, that's messing up my situation.
He's going to want to stay.
He's going to want to stay, and he's going to be all up in my business.
But what do you, I feel like you like Renzo, though. Like, maybe you should try
it. I do, but I don't know if my life, I don't know that I don't know
can
if that's
get
exotic enough for me to be just here. I mean, here I'm fine. I have a good life on my own. You know, I've worked it out where in my head I live in a hotel. You know what I mean? Like, we iron my sheets
in
at
my
home.
Head.
It's like a thing. And, you know, I live right next door to my favorite hotel. And then I go down there and they make my dinner and my breakfast. And, like, I have a good thing going for myself.
Right, right.
I don't want
I know
him
you're
to go
happy.
And mess it up. I mean, I've got guys sending me dick pics. Like, you know, I got a good thing going. Like,
okay, well, then what are you going to say to Renzo?
No, you know, it was just interesting how unattractive that sounded to me in that moment. Other people would say, oh, that's so sweet. But I was kind of thinking, but what about my jet setter lifestyle? Like, no, you stay over there and let me come to you and then come back home to D.C. when I need to.
I think that's going to be hard to do because I don't think most people are going to, they're going to want you, you know, they're going to want to see you like when they want to see you. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. That's kind of a relationship.
Oh, really? Is that what?
You know, like, I don't know the one where you did Renzo, buy the place in Barcelona on the beach.
No, he suggested that, by the way.
Okay, well, so he suggests that, but, like, you're basically like, I'll fly there, you fly us to Barcelona, then you fly us here and there, and then I'm out.
Well, then I'd come home and come back to work for a while, you know. I can't a whole bunch of these podcasts. I didn't tape a bunch of these, tell you about my life experiences. Oh my God. I go on back home.
I swear to God, like, I honestly, the day, there's going to be one day where you are just going to be ongoing unavailable, that you will just run off to some country with some guy. I'll be like...
This is not happening.
You'll be like, no, call me. I'll be on the show. No, we're not calling you. You're too much. All right, really quickly, there's a listener that had an email, and she wants to know how she can quit her job and start living her dream.
About it.
Hey, Sarah. You and Paul inspire me. The subject says it all. I've been a fan since you were on a morning show, on the morning show on Hot 99.5. I enjoyed the short tenure on 107.3 as well, and now I listen to the podcast. You really inspire me, and I love what you're doing and what you love. I'm in the middle of a sort of crisis myself, some health issues that keep me grounded so I don't take things for granted, and the realization that it's time to leave my job.
Wow.
But what do I do now? I took this job when I was exiting an industry I was weary of, and the company is just not for me. Time to regroup and move on. I hope to one day understand what I am passionate about, what makes me tick. Love you guys. What do you think? So how do you think, have you always known what your passion is? Is it hard for you to find that?
I knew that when I tried to go to a desk job, I thought I had narcolepsy. I mean, I would literally fall asleep at the desk. I could not. I had an overwhelming sense that I wanted to crawl under the desk and go to sleep. No, I couldn't.
You cracked
like,
me up.
Like, almost 911 worthy. So I knew I had to do something on my own. Like, I couldn't do it. I wasn't going to be able to keep a job.
In your cubicle, and you just like...
By the way, this shit lasted, like, a matter of weeks. I mean, it just didn't last. I couldn't do it.
Would you quit? You just quit?
I used to have these fantasies that I would go out the front door of the office and just start running down the street, and I did.
That's how you left?
I was like 17 years old. I was working at a place in Rockville, and then we're going to get to this
this is a story, because I, you know, you have to find these things. So I think.
But yeah, I mean, I knew what I was supposed to do was stay there and work, but I was working at a temp company. This is before I moved to New York. I graduated when I was 17 years old, and I got a job at a temp company.
Love it.
And I worked at the front desk of the temp company on Rockville Pike called Advantage Staffing. And I just was obsessed with leaving this job or crawling under my desk. So one day I decided to leave the job, and I like got my shit. I went down the elevator. I opened the front door of the office building, and I ran down Rockville Pike at full speed. Like, it was in my head, I was in a movie. And then I realized, oh shit, I need my check next week. So I went back.
Sorry, just long, extended lunch break.
Right. I went back all winded. And I just sat there and, like, you know, passed the time. So basically, it didn't take me long to realize that
I was not
dying a slow death. Like,
I always tell people this, you know, because I've known since I was very, very little that I've always wanted to be a broadcaster. I've always wanted to entertain people. So, but, you know, you find along the journey that not every job is right for you.
Sure.
So I think the biggest thing that people can do is financial freedom, and I'd be curious to see what you think, because you've been very independent for a long time, but financial freedom is really the key to everything.
Yeah.
Like, most people cannot leave the job they hate because they have a mortgage, they have a house, all these things that I don't think you really need.
Yeah.
And like, I'm not buying a house now because I'm saving money because we have a podcast business. Like, this is like just launching, you know? So people get themselves in these situations, and I think it makes them so unhappy later on.
Yeah.
So my advice for you, Megan is the woman's name, is you obviously want to leave this job. Start saving every penny. How can you downsize, whittle your life that you're saving half of your paycheck? Because I think, too, people get in such a depressed place with their job. It's also hard to look for a new one.
Yeah.
You know, you physically don't feel good. You don't look good. But if you can save up for the next 8-9 months, then put yourself on a budget, and it's probably going to take you 6 months to find a job. Meanwhile, I would be taking, you know, keeping a list. Like, what are the things that you think you want to try?
Sure, sure. I think learning how to do what you really want to do, not just knowing, oh, I want to be this. I want to be like a TV host. Okay. So I wanted to be a TV host. And in the beginning, I was getting these jobs at MTV and VH1 and TV Land. Oh, wow, this is going great. Then that dried up. So the best thing I could have ever done for myself is what I tell you is I learned how to produce a show. You know?
Brilliant.
So
yeah.
When the jobs dried up, I learned how to produce a show. Then I was like the sales guy, the writer, the producer, the host. And I did it. You know, I sold it to sponsors. I produced it. I aired it, promoted it, aired it, you know, and then I did that over and over and over again. So, you know, you'll never really go broke. But it was interesting. I was watching the guy Gary Vee. You know,
yes. Oh, I love him. Yeah. Gary Vaynerchuk.
Yeah. And he was saying the other day, he was like, you know, the best way to never own a part of the Porsche company is to buy a Porsche.
Oh,
He was like, because, you know, you're taking all of that. He said that will slow you down because you're taking all that money and you're taking all that energy and you're putting it into this thing. And you can't use that money or that energy and that time that you're focusing on this Porsche on building your own empire.
Exactly.
So the best way to do that is to buy. So, you know, of course, you know, you got to have one or two. I mean, you know what I'm saying?
Well, you get to Gary Vee's level and then you do.
And then
you have
can
it.
Do that.
But what I love about Gary Vee is, like, I think we're all so impatient. You know, mm-hmm. everybody wants the results now. Everyone wants to quit their job today. Like, you have to have a financial plan. I think that's the biggest thing. Or, you know, too, I think people get very caught up in, like, I've got to know immediately what I want to do. It's like, all right. If there's an industry or something you like producing, right? Mm-hmm. That wasn't what you started out to do, but production ended up leading you to what you wanted.
Sure.
So sometimes, too, I think you have to try things like, okay, I'm kind of interested in X, Y, or Z.
Yeah.
Try it for a while. It doesn't mean you have to stay with it.
Yeah, I wasn't at the mercy of other people deciding
right.
how far I was going to go with me learning how to produce a show.
Still the case, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, I could go on and on. I'm on an independent kick today.
Come on, do it, girl.
I'm like,
come on.
Do not
buy
work for the
out.
Man. They mm-hmm. are never going to, they're never, yeah. The man is totally safe. They're never going to promote you. They never want you to be a star. They're mm-hmm. just never, it's, yeah. Do you think I've been in radio? Sorry, I work for like too many radio media companies, but I'm just like, no, you know, yeah. you have to create it on your own, especially now. There's so many outlets.
Doesn't it feel good?
Feels amazing. Because when you work for someone else, you always mm-hmm. wonder, well, could I do it? Do sure. I have what it takes? Am I as talented as everyone else? But then when you get out and do it and you put one foot in front of the other, it's like, oh my God, no, I'm really doing it. But I also think, you know, you and I have a grit that I don't think a lot of people, mm-hmm. not everybody has, you know?
Sure.
I think we're over the rejection part. It's like, cool, you don't like me, we're on to the next.
No problem, no, on to the next.
Yeah, you know, so, but not everybody has that. People, you know.
And one thing I learned over time, and this is just maturity in terms of being magnanimous, is like, I don't always need to be the guy. Like, I don't need to be the guy, like the one guy that's
right.
doing it all. So, you know, that's why for me.
I still struggle with that. Yeah, I like
right. Well, this podcast works for me because, you know, whether we're in a sales meeting, whether we're doing show prep, whether we're doing this actual podcast or promoting it or hosting an event. Listen, being the guy, the one guy, that's a lot of work.
Yeah.
I mean, you only have so much energy to go around. And you know what? Sometimes if I'm not like, oh, Helen, you got it. And if you're not, then I got it. And I like that yin and that yang. So if
I
you
agree.
Can find someone else, just because you partner with someone else doesn't mean like, oh, you can do it on your own or you're not successful. It just means that, hey, you found somebody else that has the same, you know, vision.
Yep.
And dedication, and you're working toward the same goal. But hey, it's nice to bounce something off of somebody else.
Oh my God, I love it.
You know?
Paul!
Sarah!
Amazing! You guys, look, we love you. You can always follow us on social media. It's Paul Wharton Style on Instagram, Paul Wharton on Twitter. It's at Hey Frage on Instagram, on Twitter. You can always email us, Sarah at
HeyFrage.com.
We want
your letters. I love to hear from the listeners.
The emails are great. PaulWhartonStyle@yahoo.com. We have to thank Pacers. They're amazing, and they keep us in this awesome studio. So
thank
we
you
love
so
Pacers.
Much, Pacers. We love
oh my God.
You.
I like a little juicy booty. This
juicy
is like
juicy booty. Juicy booty.
We're probably going to get so many emails. The women are going to be like,
I am not supporting
support
this.
Him? I'm not buying his music.
We're not buying this.
I mean,
we're
totally streaming
this off.
It. Yeah, exactly. Okay, my love. Thank you to Pacers. Check them out. They've got a Pace the Nation podcast, or you can go to runpacers.com.
And definitely, I'm hosting an event next Wednesday, November 15th at UDC, the UDC Homecoming Fashion Show. And I'm hosting it with Sharice Jordan and Monique Samuels from the Real Housewives of Potomac. So check it out. Get your tickets at udc.edu/homecoming.
Love.
We'll see you there.
Bye, you
Bye.
Guys.
We love you.
Love you. Bye, everybody.
What's the phrase that you hear every day? Hey, phrase. What's the phrase that you hear every day? Hey, phrase. What's the phrase that you hear every day? Hey, phrase. What's the phrase that you